This is Ham Radio Now, episode 285 and Emcomm episode number 5. So that's why co-host David Goldenberg is here on the screen right from the beginning. From the West Coast Bureau of Ham Radio Now.
Right.
And the title of today's show is A Very Good Day. You'll find out why. Yeah.
That's right.
In a little bit. So welcome back again.
Thank you much, Gary. Glad to be here. Glad we were able to work this out.
Yep. Coming up later on in the program, we are going to talk to the guys, Paul English from Mars, that we talked to before their very bad day. I think I just gave it away.
Yeah, you did. That's okay.
Yeah. They've had their exercise. I recorded some audio and video from making the contact, and we'll talk about that. And then he and another fellow from Mars, Stapchuk, KD9DXM, will be joining us. He will be just audio. We've discovered if you're on a tablet, and he was on a tablet, you can't mix in with the video, so you become just radio star. So, and we'll have a good long discussion about the results of the exercise, and then plenty more Mars stuff. So, cool stuff. Before we get to that, well, two things before we get to that. First of all, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. And your conduit for doing that is that guy with the Santa hat on, Arvin, our mascot. He would like you to stop by hamradionow.tv and go down to the bottom, find his icon, get to our contribution page, and you can kick in some money. Either part of Patreon, monthly contribution, as little as $1 a month, so 12 bucks a year, or individual credit card contributions, or PayPal. All of that stuff works. And thank you very much. Oops, that's just you. We need both of us here.
There's us both. There we go.
Before we get to that, a couple of weeks ago, you had an interesting exercise that you took part
in. Yeah, absolutely. So every year, the state of California does a statewide hospital disaster drill, and the mission our ARES groups has is working with the hospitals directly. And so it's always on a Thursday. And we get out and get to play radio for the day. I took the day off work, and we deployed all across Los Angeles County, up into the Palmdale area, and worked directly with the hospitals. So I know I sent you a bunch of pictures and other information there. Can I summarize it all together? That's from we call it our alpha location. There's an old retired Nike base that they used to use for missile trackings up on the top of the hill, kind of between the valley and the city. And we pulled our mobile command trailer up there.
So you were up on top of a hill. I can see in the distance.
Yep. I was up on the top of the hill. I don't know. I'm not sure exactly where I am then. I guess probably taking that picture, or maybe that was somebody else. But yeah, you can see in the distance the valley down below, the San Fernando Valley. And we used this command trailer to kind of be our net control. And
have things in Los Angeles changed a lot where in that picture you can see a mountain range in the distance? And mm-hmm. Let me put the picture back up again. My recollection of Los Angeles is that's not possible.
Yeah, you know, the AQMD, the Air Quality Management District, over the years, you know, I remember being a teenager in the 70s and the 80s, you couldn't see across the valley. It would just be a big brown muck. And, you know, the introduction of unleaded fuels and all of the air quality measures have really improved things a lot. And you can most of the time see from mountaintop to mountaintop.
Okay. So, and that's what we're looking at here, down in the valley, and you can see all the way across. It looks like a relatively normal sky anyplace else, where it just, you know, it hazes a little bit.
Yep.
But not really bad. I'm impressed.
Yeah. And it was, and that actually was a very nice day. It was, we had great weather. Wasn't too hot.
A very good day.
That was a very good day.
All right.
Was a good day.
Tell us about the exercise.
So, the exercise every year, it's a different scenario. Hospitals are required for, certification to hold, two drills a year, and whether they do tabletop or full scale drill. And, this particular simulation, and they vary from year to year. This particular simulation was of a train versus bus. And and some of the situations don't always lend themselves to amateur radio support. But this particular one participated anyways, a train versus bus, a mass casualty kind of incident. And so we, end up as, I don't know, for the fourth level or the fifth level of communication in the system in case there is a failure. But we go and we work with the hospital groups directly, pass traffic back and forth. That's the inside of the communication trailers. We kind of have four stations set up. We had six people there, I think, running net control and backup. I think I'm all the way over on the left there, all the way on the right. That's my where my FL Digi station was set up. We did pass some digital traffic back and forth. That particular trailer we've been working on for, I guess, 2.5 or 3 years now. It's all 100% volunteer. We own it. We put everything into it.
There you are.
And yep, there I am. We drag that thing all over the place, including the Baker to Vegas race. So the drill, typically the way the drills go is, we set it up to start at a certain time. I think the incident in this particular drill was supposed to happen at 8 o'clock. We asked for stations to check in. A lot of times what we'll do is we'll activate them via text message and email. We'll ask stations to check in, and then we'll deploy them out to a hospital location. Now, when we do the drills, usually we'll tell them, hey, you're going to end up here, but don't show up there right away. You know, go a couple blocks away and then we'll deploy you, because we want people to get activated, go there, figure out where they need to go, find the people that they're going to work with. We have a number of forms that we work with the county that they mandate to us, the MCI forms and the hospital assessment forms. So really what we're doing is helping to relay bed counts. And hospital status. If there was an earthquake, a hospital might not be available. So I don't know if you want to pull up those forms.
So there's one.
That's the hospital assessment form. And basically what the hospital assessment form says, at this given time, we're under this service, right? So we're normal operations, or we have special controls in place, or impaired, or even not available. And then we provide bed count information. So we have the medical alert center, and their job is to route ambulances and support resources across the county. And so we collect this information directly from the hospital. So there'll be a liaison that we work with there, or the direct disaster coordinator, or an RN, or someone that runs the ER, and we'll work with them to get that information around bed counts around the hospital, because they want to know how many people that they can bring to the hospital for the different areas of the hospital. So if you look at that form again in the bottom half, they look for bed count availability. So, you know, the medical, the surgical, the telemetry ICU, pediatric ICU, the neonatal ICU, pediatrics, and so on and so forth. So they want to know how many beds are available, so how many people they could route to the hospital at any given time.
So this is going from the get all the pictures straightened away here. This is going from a tactical unit in the field back to the hospital?
No. So what happens is there's a central location in Santa Fe Springs here, and that's the group that coordinates the medical response to major incidents. And what happens is we collect this in the field from the hospitals, and we send it to the medical alert center so they can have an idea across the county where they can route patients to if, you know, there's an accident in Northridge, but the Northridge hospital is either overwhelmed or they're not available. They'll know what the surrounding hospitals have in terms of bed availability and be able to route the patients or victims or whatever you want to call them to those locations.
So the information in that form starts with a hospital.
Yes, it starts at the hospital.
Which you're calling the field.
Yeah, in the field.
Disconnect for me.
Sorry.
So the hospital is the field.
Yes, exactly. And they have several, there are several different paths for that form to get in. There's a MediNet system that they have, internet-based computers that are in, it's in every ER and other parts of the hospital as well. They enter that information into that MediNet system. In fact, when they fill out the form, they go to the MediNet system and pull that information out. What we found over the years is as we do the drills, when you load the MediNet system with a lot of data all at the same time, it doesn't always hold up as well as the county would like. In fact, a lot of times when we do drills, it crashes. And so, you know, we're there to back that system up and provide that information.
And that's a standard internet-based?
Yeah, it's an internet-based system. So again, you have the challenges around, you know, if the internet's not up in a disaster situation as well.
Yeah.
So we end up backing it up, and we will, whether the system's up or not, we relay that traffic so that they have multiple modes of having it.
Is that one of those forms that you can send as a pre-built form in NBeams?
We do have the form built out in NBeams, and we're trying to get more and more operators up and running, including an operator at the MAC to receive those so that they can print them out and hand them off. We're getting there. I'm hoping next year we'll have more penetration in terms of operators that are capable of doing that from all the locations.
Yeah. I'm getting the terminology down. I got the NBeams thing in there.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
which stands for what?
Narrowband Emergency Messaging Service. And that may be another one of our shows down the road.
Which, oh yeah. We'll concentrate on that.
Yeah, absolutely.
But briefly, it's on VHF, it'd be packet radio.
You know, you could do, it's not packet radio. It's basically sound card modem. So it's voice traffic and not UHF, VHF. You can do HF as well. There's just different modes that you can use, whether you're using MT63 or Olivia, or there's a bunch of different modes, and each different mode has its specific area that you want to use it in, specific frequency.
Okay. But the formatting would be the data that you're sending. It's not sending the whole form. It's sending probably a little header that says, here's a field. Here's the data. Form.
Yeah,
here's a field. Here's the data.
Yeah. That's the great thing about the software that was written is it has the form. It's a beautiful, nice HTML form that you can print out. And each one of the fields has its, you know, number that's associated with each individual form. And I think they have 40 or 50 kind of pre-cammed forms. Red Cross has their forms in there. There's the ICS forms in there. There's, you know, aerial radiogram forms in there. There's a whole bunch of different organizations that have forms. They give you the ability to build your own. So we're building our own for the LA County system to make those forms. And you number each field, and it only sends, you know, sends a number, field number one, and the data is this, field number two, and the data is that. So you cut down on how much information you have to send back and forth.
Okay, here's your other form.
So this is the high priority traffic. So this is the one we do first, typically when an incident occurs. And so this lets you know, you ask the ED, the emergency department, how many people can they take immediate, delayed, or minor. It gives them an idea, again, in that major incident, what they can take right away and how quickly they can take it. And there's also information around, you know, patient type and where they're going and where they're transported.
All right. And so a hospital generates this information. And
then we get that form, you know, and we'll go and stand with the person that's responsible for filling it out. We'll get that form. We'll take it back. We'll jump on our net, and the hospital will call net control. They will report that information. Now, occasionally the MAC will ask specifically, hey, go back to the hospitals and get an update so that, you know, they have an update, and it'll, you know, typically we'll do it on the hour or on the halves and provide those updates. So again, so they have kind of a moving vision of what's going on, you know, a mass casualty. I think this one, you know, they train hit a school bus full of kids. So there's a lot of kids to go, a lot of people on the train. You could estimate, you know, 40, 50, 60 people would need to be transported to hospitals. It doesn't all happen at once. It happens over a period of time. They have to, you know, extract the victims from the accident and move them along, wait for the ambulances to come. So they'll ask for periodic updates from the hospitals to see, hey, can I continue to send people there or victims there or reroute them to other locations?
Yeah, I would imagine this is all very fluid, that things change pretty quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And in your experience, how many people can an individual hospital accommodate? I suppose that depends on what their current load is before the tragedy. Yeah.
A lot of it depends on, you know, what's the situation at, you know, at the given time, and they practice for lots of different scenarios. So, you know, there's the last year we did like a pandemic flu, right? And that's a different kind of ramp up than you have for like a train versus bus accident. The train versus bus accident, it happens. 9:04, that accident occurred. And then you respond to that. But in the kind of the pandemic flu thing, you know, it kind of started the night before. People start streaming into the ERs and they're sick and they're not well. And they, you know, they start to check them out and do the tests and they start to figure out everybody's got this influenza, this or the influenza that. And that's kind of a different thing where there's not a lot of maybe hospital or like ambulance traffic, but they want to know as the hospitals start to fill up where we get into a situation where we do need to either deploy additional people or equipment or mobile hospital units out to specific areas when they're, you know, getting overwhelmed.
I had a question and I'm not sure what exactly it was. It was something about getting your involvement in the timetable for getting that. When you have the really specific incident, like the train accident, how fast do you guys respond?
So some of it has to do with, you know, how, so the MAC will receive notice of an incident, right? And then they contact an EC or a DC, depending on, you know, they have numbers for a bunch of different people. And then we go out to our text message and email alerting system. So, you know, we blast out to all the people that are on our roster and ask for people to get on the net so that they can tell us you're available, you're not available, and then they will deploy you out. Other kinds of activation.
How long does that take?
It'll really vary. So like an earthquake, right? An earthquake, everybody knows, get on the radio. Go out, get on our frequencies, check into the net. If you're the first one there, you start up the net until someone, you know, more superior to you in rank or better location gets on the net, and then you run with the net, you take check-ins, and then we coordinate. We'll reach out to the MAC when they have radios there to see, do you need us to deploy? You reach out to your local hospital to see what kind of support they need, and then it goes from there. That's a really quick kind of up and running.
Okay, so when something happens and you know to get on the radio, you also know what frequency to get on.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. As part of the ARES organization, you're supposed to know you get on this repeater system if it's up and running, or you get on this simplex frequency otherwise.
All right, so you start on a repeater.
Because of the way the logistics in Los Angeles County were so large, it's almost impossible to cover it all. Like if we were up on the hill at the Nike base, ready to go from there, you get a really good footprint and really good coverage. There's some of the operators I know are Marty Wall is he's the regional vice director. He participates in the ARES group. He's got a big station on the side of the Chatsworth Hill and a lot of good equipment. He can hear pretty much everybody's simplex, but not everybody has that capability.
All right. So do you guys go up on the hill a lot, or is it just part of a drill?
So for drills, we're typically up there for a drill. Where you see us now is behind a gate. It's a locked gate on a fire road. We have tentative approval to use this in a disaster situation, so we can get up and access this location. If there is an event that occurs and we are needed to get up to that hill and get deployed like that, probably take an hour to get to the trailer because the trailer's not kept there, get up the hill and get a couple operators there. There are some other folks. You can see there's a couple cars. So that's Northridge Hospital. That's the team of hams that are deployed there.
You guys would be outside?
Yeah, typically, you know, it's better for the radio. And again, a lot of the stuff that we deal with is earthquakes, right? So you don't want to be be inside a building for that. And what will happen is you'll deploy several operators. So there will be an operator inside the hospital, inside the emergency department. And they'll be simplex, you know, UHF or VHF simplex with the team that's outside so that they can move the traffic back and forth.
Okay. So you're just, yeah, using some handy talkies like this one I see here.
Yep. And then you see that's Dan. Dan's got his go box there. And then we'll use that for the longer range communications.
Okay. Interesting that you would be outside. I hadn't thought that would be the case, but it is sort of a situation specific that you've got.
There are some of the hospitals that we deploy to that have ham equipment there already. And in those cases, we will deploy inside. So at the, one of the hospitals that when I first started, before I became an EC, West Hills Hospital is the one that's closest to my home. And they've got a nice Comet antenna. They've got a nice Kenwood radio. It's all programmed and ready to go. And it is on a corner desk between the facilities and the operations manager. And you couldn't stand if they're both sitting at their chairs. And so it's usable. And in a disaster situation, you could get on the radio, but it's not very well logistically positioned there. So a lot of times, if we're going to deploy to that hospital in an emergency, then, you know, I'll have my car there with an antenna on the trailer hitch, and there'll be a ham inside, and we'll talk back and forth on simplex, and we'll relay the traffic most likely from the parking lot.
So you would think that if it takes an hour to get going and a bus has hit a train, that by the time you guys get going, it's going to be all over. But that's probably not really true.
It's probably not really true. And, you know, a lot of the times in our bigger deployments, it's probably more earthquake related. But we have been activated for other things. So, there was a situation here where AT&T was digging a ditch outside of a hospital and they cut through the fiber optic line of the hospital. All the phone systems were down internally and externally. And, you know, Matt called us, and within, I think, 40 minutes, we had six or eight operators at the hospital, and you deploy them across the hospital, primarily handy talkies, the emergency room, the X-ray radiology department, the pharmacy, the NICU, the ICU, and those, and radialing orders back and forth, working with the internal folks in the hospital so that they have the communications they need. And we also had another operator that was outside on a higher power radio coordinating with the outside world for the information that they needed as well. So it varies. And, you know, every deployment's kind of different. So we just kind of, we get up and we go and we take the stuff that we think we need, and hopefully we have the right equipment for the mission.
And your mandatory equipment for the guys who are going to run around the hospital with a handy talkie is a single half dead battery.
Yeah. They're, you know, we have a hope you have this go bag deployment, and, you know, part of your go bag is spare batteries. And, you know, you can, you know, you want to have a battery, one in your radio and a backup. And then we also recommend that people get, you know, for most radios now, you can get a pack that you can put AA batteries in. It doesn't do the full power that most of the radios can do, but typically it's enough.
Keeps so you on that,
air. Yeah, exactly.
And you can always get more AA batteries.
That's exactly right.
Do you use UHF or VHF? And what kind of building penetration do you typically get? Some of those buildings are pretty big and pretty deep.
They are, and you end up figuring out how to relay depending on where you are, if necessary. Most of it, and again, it varies. You know, you get to the site and you test it out, and we have a frequency list that's two pages, one on each side, and one of it's the repeaters that we one column's the repeaters we use, and the other column are the simplex frequencies. Everybody's supposed to have everything programmed. It's not always the case. And, you know, you work through, we know, you know, our primary simplex frequency, tactical frequency is not what you're going to use if you're deployed just within a hospital, because that's to get you on the net outside. So we have the other frequencies that we're going to want you to use, and you get on those frequency, and it may be that you need to do some tests. Okay, we'll try this one. Oh, we'll try that one, depending on noise and other information.
Use mostly UHF, into the hospitals or?
Yeah, typically.
No problem with getting people that have enough equipment, the right bands and frequencies.
No, the biggest problem is making sure everybody has the updated frequencies programmed. That's really the biggest problem. Yeah. Everybody has every ham's got an HT, and that's part of that. That's the basic, you know, equipment you need. We want you to have taken a couple of the ICS, the FEMA courses. We want you to have an HT. We want you to have a little go bag so that, you know, you have the medications you need, a couple, you know, candy bars or snack bars so that you have some food, some water, the extra batteries, you know, something to write on, with you at all the time so that you can go and bring it along. And then other folks have bigger sets of equipment, right? I've got two big bags in my garage, you know, sitting next to the stuff that I might need to deploy if it's a bigger deployment. And, you know, the radios that are in my car, and, you know, one of them I can set up to crossband. So, if I get to a hospital and I'm the first one there, I set the one in the car up to crossband. Then I go inside with my HT. If I need to get out to the outside world and I don't have the ability to do that there, I jump on the crossband and use the radio in my car to do that.
Do you try to get everybody to be very capable and flexible in programming their radios on the fly?
On the panel? Yeah, we do. We do want them to all be able to do that, but we also want you to be able to have those frequencies that, you know, are pre-canned.
Yeah, ready. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, a couple times a year, we get everybody, we meet once a month. And a couple times a year during the meetings, we'll ask everybody, you know, bring your equipment along, bring your programming cables, and everybody bring all that and a couple laptops. And if you need help, we'll get you programmed.
Yeah. I wrote I think it was a radio review for QST that I began differently than I'm going to say anybody has ever begun a radio review. Uh-huh. The first line was, CJ had disappeared from the net. What kind of a radio review could that be?
Right.
It involved being able to program radios, and that it was, I think it was one of the marathons we had going here, and CJ, KJ4OJO, CJ, I'm sorry, I'm not remembering your call sign really well. Very enthusiastic, not particularly technical, but a very enthusiastic ham and a fairly new ham. And she had a Yaesu radio. I speak fluent ICOM. Yep. I speak Kenwood with an ICOM accent. I speak no Yaesu.
Yeah.
The only Yaesu I speak is for my 8900, which is not, it is standard with a Yaesu accent.
Mm-hmm.
Not Yaesu.
And even if you know that 8900, it doesn't all translate over to the HT.
Yeah, it doesn't help me at all with like a VX5 or 7 or whatever. Yep. That's what she had.
And we do run into that. Mostly it's when we go to events. So, you know, we work a bunch of races. You know, we get out there and do a lot of community service. So I know every year I can rely on when we go to the AC, the Angeles Crest 100 race. Which is a 100-mile ultra marathon race. So an individual will run 100 miles in about 25 hours or something like that. And
then they die. And then you bring in the hospital stuff.
Yeah, exactly. But I will tell you, every year when we deploy out to that, I will program at least 2, if not more, Baofengs for not our folks, but the other hams that support the race in other ways, because a lot of those people will have gotten their ham tickets.
So you're good at chirp.
Yeah. No, I mostly hand program them because they want a frequency. They want to be able to listen to the local whatever. And so I'll hand program those. I mean, I do have chirp along, but
these are not easy to program by hand.
No, they're not. Weird. They're not. But I'm the CCC specialist in our group.
Yep.
I prefer the Woshans. I really like those radios. That was the second radio I bought after I bought a FT60 when I first got licensed. And I really like the Woshans. I have a number of those. And the programming for that is very, very similar to the programming for the Baofeng. And so I can handle those. There are other guys that I don't speak Kenwood. I don't speak the ICOM. You know, if you give me an HT, for the most part, I can get you on a simplex frequency. If you've got to do the offset and whatever, sometimes we muddle through it. Otherwise I go find, you know, go talk to this guy or go talk to that guy.
ICOMs were the first radios I learned to program. And so that to me is the way things should be. And, you know, everything else is a derivation or a wrong direction, a misdirection. So the reason CJ disappeared from the net, cause she had been on the net. And we were on a repeater. It was a subaudible tone required repeater. And she had programmed the frequency for the repeater in, she did everything right. She programmed everything well in advance. She went nuts programming that radio and another radio, everything well in advance. But she got on site and had programmed the tone for the repeater wrong.
Yep.
So she was able to get in to the programming of the radio on the panel, change the tone. Everything was fine. She was on the net. Switched to a simplex frequency, switched back. She had not stored changed programming. Totally flummoxed. Because some radios will. If you change the tone on a memory and you leave and you come back, it'll be the new tone.
Some won't. Not
those Yaesus and not the icons.
And you know, when I, right before I hand that Balfang back to somebody that I programmed for that one frequency, and usually it's only one that they need anyways, I lock it. And, because the other thing that happens is, you know, they put it on their belt and they bang it and they switch onto the next frequency up or down or whatever. And I lock it. And occasionally people come back to me saying, hey, can't move this or change this. How do I unlock it?
Yeah. We would like everybody to really understand how to program their radios. And I mean, this is the Emcomm Extra. In theory, we're talking to an Emcomm audience. I hope we're talking to a wide variety of people that are interested in getting into it and people who have proven their chops. And those are the guys that are going, these Gary and David don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah, you know, you really need to be able to do that front panel programming. And it is really key. And we do emphasize that. It's hard to test. It's hard to do. You know, we'll have at an occasional meeting, we'll do a tabletop kind of drill where we put people, we have a big meeting room. We'll put people in different corners and occasionally we'll throw out another frequency because when you get deployed, you may find out, hey, you're working with the ACS fire group or the DCS group that works with the sheriff department and they're on different frequencies and they're on different repeaters and you need to be able to step up and do that.
Yeah.
And not everybody can.
Is the exercise, are you part of an incident command structure? Is it a formal ICS?
You know, when we do our exercises, typically the hospital will do it in the incident command structure. So the ham that's at the hospital that's working with that organization, with that hospital, they will report up through that group or the hospital will, you know, they'll have an incident commander and they'll have the, you know, four reports and it'll work that way. Our organization, you know, you check into the net and we forward the information to the MAC. So we kind of work under that, but you don't see it a lot on the nets or outside of it unless you're deployed at a hospital per se.
All right. The exercise that you were on a couple of weeks ago, was it purely ham radio or were you part of a hospital drill?
I was, so it depended on which hospital you got deployed to. So, you know, a lot of times I act as one of the net control operators. And so we're up on the hill so that we can catch all the simplex traffic. Cause we're really, really, we know that's how it's going to go.
That's why you're not just sitting at home. That's why you go up.
Yeah, exactly. And so, I know like you showed pictures of, Northridge Hospital where, Dan and a number of the other folks were, they had a little bit more than a tabletop exercise. They actually did some stuff. One of the hospitals, I don't remember which hospital it was, they did a full on moulage drill where, you know, they put victims with makeup and blood and they had ambulances bring them in and they took them off the gurneys and they brought them into the ER and they triaged them. And it varies from hospital to hospital. They're not mandated to do full scale, but, different hospitals, you know, they have different priorities. And so some of them want to do that and some of them don't.
So I guess that topic or that question goes to how high above you guys in ham radio are participating in the drill in terms of emergency management or hospital management.
Yep. Yep.
And some of both. Do they ever or very often give you a scenario where you are the communications, you're doing that?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
All else fails thing.
I think it was 2 years ago was an earthquake. And we were the path. And then I think the year before that, I don't remember exactly what the scenario was, but that was the year that MediNet crashed. And because it crashed,
you were the path. The primary, really were. Yeah.
And they could have done it over the phone, but you know, that was the opportunity for them to say, okay, well, let's try this out and see what happens.
And how did it go?
It went pretty well. It went pretty well.
Come on.
You know, the
be forthcoming.
You know what? It does work pretty well when we get it going, and you know we adjusted things over years. You know, originally the MAC, it's in Santa Fe Springs, is kind of out to the east of where we are. Originally, management there and kind of management of our organization said, "Hey, everything has to be point to point. You can't relay communications." And you know where I am is 40 plus miles from that location as the crow flies. And there's a lot of dirt in between. And
there's no point-to-point path.
No, you're not doing simplex between those two locations.
So why do they want you to be point-to-point? I mean, you're playing the telephone game, and you can screw things up going...
That's part of it. So some of the traffic they're going to pass back and forth. You saw that we went through those forms, but there are some other forms that we have. So requisitions for medication or personnel or equipment, and they want to make sure that those requisitions come directly from that hospital, right? If I get on with the MAC and I tell them I need 5 cases of morphine, you know, and a ton of lactated ringers or whatever it happens to be, they want to know I'm not some crank and that I'm coming from that hospital directly. And it's not relayed through somebody else. You know, the relaying through somebody else, like you said, it does introduce the possibility for errors.
Yeah. So what did you do?
You know, we do the best we can. We have to,
in that case, you said, I can't.
We can't do it. Well, we try. And that's a lot of times what we'll do is when we start up the nets early on, we will start them up on a repeater system because those are always up and running when we drill. And then we'll move over to simplex and we'll do a simplex test.
Yeah. Do you have any temporary repeaters, field portable, deployable?
We're working on some.
And you talked about crossband repeat at the hospital, but what about just, you know, putting a crossband repeater up on the hill?
Yeah, and then we're working towards doing some of that. But what we found is because there's 66 hospitals in Los Angeles County, it works better to have a couple of different points. And actually, one of the things we did this year is we signed all the hospitals. You know, everybody has a tactical call, but we did is we assigned them on the chart, and everybody had the chart number. So when we initially did the initial check-in, sometimes it could take a half an hour to get all the 60 hospitals checked in. But what we did was we used our location to take the valley, and we had another location set up to the east and one set up in the city to take all the initial check-ins from the hospitals. And then when we relayed them to the MAC, we did it in 5 minutes by saying, okay, we're checking in hospital 1, 2, 5, 8, 9, 14. And it cuts down the traffic and the amount of information that the MAC has to deal with. And that worked. That actually, this time it worked really well. We were really impressed with that.
The folks that you're working for have an appreciation of how thin the pipe is when you become the conduit for all the communications? Do you guys have an appreciation for it?
Yeah, I think some of us do and some of us don't. I think they put us in the bucket where we're their lifeline to the MAC, and the MAC is their kind of command and control on, yes, I'm getting ambulance traffic, I'm getting more patients in, or yes, I have a need for something that I need, whether it be a person or equipment or medication to get there. And that's really the mission. And that's as big or as small as we're able to do in those kinds of events. Again, like the hospital that had the phone line cut, you know, they asked for help and we step up and we do that. And they understand that there's limitations, but we're better than, you know, sending a nurse to run to the elevator and up the floor and back to the pharmacy and back and forth. And they're very appreciative once they see what the capabilities are. And sometimes you kind of have to work your way in. You know, you work with a new hospital administrator and, you know, who's this guy that shows up in the little yellow vest and he's got a radio and he's not part of my staff. And, you know, why is he sitting down at the table with us? And after a while, when they start looking for information and, you know, you chime in that you've got that, or you can send that, or you can get that, and you do that a couple times, you earn their trust and respect, and they invite you back.
Yeah, I guess that, you know, that's the key too, because trust is earned. It's not never
yep.
something you can just demand.
And that's a lot of the training is, you know, we don't show up with, you know, a big S on our chest and we're in charge, right? We're part of the solution and we're there to help.
Yeah.
And as long as you keep that mindset going, we're successful.
Do you guys ever, cause we talk about often, in the incident command, how the ham comes in and is not necessarily going to operate ham radio. Do you guys ever, step into other communications, protocols?
Yeah. So, when we show up at a location, we're communicators and we don't really differentiate between the kinds of communication that we do. You know, we'll show up with a radio and the intention is to get on our net and operate. But if we're asked to man their radio or we're asked to do other communications, we'll do what the, you know, what the customer needs. We're not pushing, you know, gurneys around, and we're not doing first aid. We're communicators, and that's the role.
Do you get enough training so that you really know how to use their radios? And
yeah, so that can be a challenge. You know, for the most part, you know, at a local hospital, the MediNet system's pretty easy to use. Otherwise, most of the hospitals, they're going to have a Kenwood or a Motorola HT, that's what they use, you know, internally for all their infrastructure, and they'll give you one of those. And those are, you know, those are dummy radios. You know, they have a dial on the top and a volume and a push to talk. And it's really there. It's just about knowing, you know, what frequency are they doing their tacticals on.
But you also need to know their procedures.
Yeah. And a lot of times it's listening and asking for, and, they'll get you up to speed pretty quick.
Okay.
So emergency coordinators at the hospitals are pretty good. They understand us. It can be challenging when you have turnover and somebody's new and they haven't done this job before. But you get them up to speed.
Yeah. Many of the people in the hospital staffs getting ham licenses?
You know, I'm seeing more and more. Hospital that I work with here, West Hills, their emergency coordinator, he started as RN in the ER. And, you know, then halftime was emergency coordination. And then he picked up security and he picked up facilities and he picked up this. And along the way, he's like, oh, yeah, I got to come in. He took one of our classes and he got licensed. And we did a full-size decontamination drill there where they brought up the blow-up tents and they brought up the showers. And they ran people through that. And while we were there deployed for the day, I met two or three other, I think there were two guys in IT and one other RN that had their tickets.
Yeah. Now, before we get QRZ.com comments or email that say, well, they're not allowed to use ham radio if they're an employee, those rules have changed. I imagine you're very familiar with them.
You know, so they're not doing business per se, and then in the event of a disaster, anything goes.
Yeah. Well, but they've also been now specifically authorized in an emergency to use ham radio for their employer. Full-on business.
I didn't realize that. I've learned something new tonight.
Go check the new rules. And there's a training component to it. I think it's an hour or two or three a week, and then 72 hours every so often. More than a year, I think. But where they can just, you know, I am employee of the hospital, and my job for this activity is to operate the amateur radio, and it's all fine. They get to do it.
Right.
Took a long time to get that through the FCC, but it did a few years ago. So
I'd be surprised that, you know, in the event, maybe initially the initial response they would get on the radio, but my expectation, you know, if you look at the way the West Hills Hospital, that's my hospital here, the emergency coordinator, he's going to have bigger and better jobs to do than get on the radio.
Yeah.
Maybe the IT guys, but the other RNs, they're going to have their hands full.
Yeah. Well, they wouldn't be the radio operator, but they could they could use the ham radio to communicate their message as opposed to having a shadow standing next to them.
Sure. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. So that it could work that way. Well, there is much, much more along these things to talk about, and that's why we're doing a continuing series of programs. But before it becomes a four-hour show, it's going to be a long show already. Is there anything else about the exercise that you want to say before we get on to the Mars stuff?
No, I mean, I think it went pretty well. We had really good participation. There's always a hospital or two that doesn't participate, from the location. It was kind of a new thing that we did this year, was that location with the kind of as a relay point. And we did a great simplex test. And I was surprised we had, from that location, I think I heard 22, different locations, you know, all across. So we had really good coverage and we had really good response. And, you know, from where we are, we're kind of Central Los Angeles area, on the mountain that we're on. And I heard all the way down to Torrance and all the way into Arcadia. So very far south and very far east and even up into the high desert. One of the things we keep talking about and working on is more of the NVIS stuff. And, you know, because we can cover the close stuff, but can we cover that, you know, 50 mile, 60 mile, kind of range, and we're getting there. We're working towards that, but it gets you into a whole other set of radios. So, Now you don't just need the UHF VHF handheld or maybe a mobile. Now you need an HF rig or an all band rig as well.
Yeah, 75 meters will do 50 or 60 miles all the time. If you want to go out, I would say 150 to 300 in the middle of the day, the doldrums, it could get too short for that. And that's where you need 60.
And that's beyond. And so that's beyond that. 150 miles is beyond what we would need to do. So
that's why I'm saying that 75 meters gives you and your little station, you know, the station sitting here behind me.
Yep.
Where is it? There it is. This one over here. That's the world's biggest, widest coverage repeater, that and a decent antenna. But although my mobile can do it too.
And that's kind of the challenge too, is getting that decent antenna out where you are, figuring out a place where you can really deploy that thing.
But my Tar Heel mobile antenna, it does a surprisingly good job.
Does it? Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I've talked mobile to mobile with guys. Driving back from Dayton to my friend Cliff, W4FT, we were both on 75 and we tried 60 a little bit. You got 15, 20 miles apart with a mountain in between us in the West Virginia mountains, and talking on 75 meters just fine. It wasn't 20 over 9. It was S2, but
You can talk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It worked fine.
Yeah.
All right. So shall we head to the Mars guys?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm looking forward to that part of this show.
So now on my Skype line, well, David, you're still on my Skype line, and Paul English is there. Paul's returning to Ham Radio Now, WD8DBY. And we've got somebody on the Skype line here who you're not going to see. You're just going to hear him. Because, well, we discovered that if you're on a tablet, Skype doesn't let you participate in multiple conversation video, just audio. So it'll be the voice of Dave Stapchuk, KD9DXM, who is the chief of Air Force Mars. So, Dave, let me welcome you to Ham Radio Now. Thanks for coming by.
Well, thanks for inviting me. I really appreciate it. This is a great opportunity to talk to you guys.
And, Paul, welcome back.
Thank you for inviting me back. Glad to be here.
So a couple of weeks ago, maybe more than a couple of weeks ago now, you guys had an exercise on 60 meters and on some local VHF repeaters around the country, and you called that a very bad day. How bad a day did it turn out to be?
Well, in reality, the actual exercise, it was a very good day for us. We had a lot of great participation from not only the Mars community, but also the amateur radio community. So while the scenario was set for a bad day, in reality, it was a good day because of the number of participants that we had across the spectrum. Dave, would you agree? Any thoughts on that?
No, I have to agree with you wholeheartedly, Paul. I got great feedback from our participants across all the regions. You know, I think if they had any complaints, it would have been about propagation or whatever. And those things are out of our control. But the participation was really good. You know, we continue to see improvements, and our interaction with the amateur community is getting stronger. Absolutely.
All right. Well, we'll talk about all that in a minute. But what I'd like to do before we go any further with the discussion of the results is I recorded two things, the broadcast, and I'm working real hard on getting things set up here. I recorded the broadcast that you guys made. The whole thing started with a 60 meter broadcast from two locations, Fort Huachuca in Arizona and some mysterious place on the East Coast. And then, and that was followed by 24 hours of making contacts. And I recorded the broadcast. In fact, David, you and I did that as a Facebook Live program that people saw, but it's never appeared here on the main show. So let me see if I can call up the broadcast here. If I can operate my technology well enough. So that's one of the stations. And tell you what, let me stop that for a second. you guys recognize that that voice, which station that was?
I do. That was from our military station on the East Coast. That is one of the young soldiers that mans that station. That station is manned 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And they were able to work into their training schedule to do this exercise. So we were very glad to have them this time and hope to use them and, more for future exercises.
Okay, so that was the East Coast station.
Yes.
And in a moment, we'll hear from the West Coast station.
All stations, all stations. Do not answer. This Alpha, Alpha, Mike, 9. Broadcast is in support of a Department of Defense high-frequency communications exercise coordinated with the Federal Emergency Management Agency. The purpose of this broadcast is the goal of achieving military and amateur radio interoperability. Radio stations are encouraged to contact military stations on this channel from 31 October through 1 November and provide a local situation report. All stations are encouraged to submit a reception report at website www.usarmymars.org. Your reception report. Please include your call sign, the state where you received the broadcast, and the broadcasting station call sign. The broadcast. This is Alpha Alpha Mike 9 out.
Okay, so if I can get things, there we go. That broadcast repeated between the two stations for, I think, about an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And was that done live, or were those recordings?
They were both done live. We had the same female soldier on the East Coast and on the West Coast, the Fort Huachuca station. We actually had two operators. The voice that you heard is David McGinnis. He's our Army Mars Chief of Operations, and he's also the manager at the Fort Huachuca Gateway Station. That radio system that he was using was one that we had just gotten activated on a new antenna field. And that was on a 5 to 30 log periodic antenna, parked at about 90 feet. And for each one of the broadcasts they did from Huachuca, they were rotating the log periodic to different azimuths to try to expand the coverage. Okay. The second operator that we had on air was Eddie Collins, who also works for the Mars program out of Huachuca.
All right. Yeah, their signal did kind of come and go, but I figured it was just propagation. And David, I think I was speculating that strong signal would have been the East Coast station. And it turns out it was the station from Arizona. So,
yeah. So what was supposed to happen, the East Coast station, we had cleared everything for them to use one of their high power transmitters up to our authorized power limit of 3K. But I think they ended up using a military radio and was pushing only 400 watts. The station at Fort Huachuca, we were actually pushing almost 1,000 watts. I think we had it up about 700 or 800 watts
from Huachuca. I wanted to hear the 3,000 watts. I was looking so forward to that. I was looking forward.
Maybe next time.
Yep. All right. So I've got something else that you sent me here. If I can pull up the PowerPoint. You set up a PowerPoint a graphic with full screen there, reception reports that you got from around the country. And this is, make this thing go away. This is both station reports. And we've also got just the signals received reports from the East Coast station and just from the Arizona station. And they almost are one for one. Almost everything was heard by everybody everywhere. About the only thing I see missing is a couple of folks in Missouri, in the middle of Missouri, disappear. Now there's a few
Nevada,
others.
Looks yeah. like Nevada too. For some changes.
But if you recognize that graphic, that's what actually ended up being the QSL card that we sent out. If you're familiar with Google Earth, If you were to zoom in on those plots, you would see a whole bunch more dots around the map. It's just when you zoom out to get the entire country, a lot of those dots merge together. We had a total of 560 reception reports that we received from amateur radio stations. Once we eliminated the duplicate reporting, we had 350 unique amateur radio call signs and some shortwave listeners who were monitoring. And from that, we sent out 304 QSL cards. The most distant stations we had from those broadcasts were two stations in Spain. We're able to hear the East Coast. And then we had four stations, and you can just barely see them at the top left of the screen. We had four stations up in Canada that received both broadcasts. And then we had stations in Hawaii who received the Fort Huachuca.
David Goldenberg, you did get one of those QSL cards, right?
I sure did. I went online and got it, and it came in the mail just 2 or 3 days ago.
Let's bring up one more thing then, and that is my actual 60-meter contact with a station just down the road from me, maybe 60, 70 miles away. And this is what my 60-meter contact sounded like.
Good evening, sir. I got you loud and clear. Is that November 4, Victor Alpha, over?
That's right. November 4, Victor Alpha in Fairfax County. Fairfax County in Northern Virginia, over.
Has any other Mars station contacted you to get information on your account, over?
I spoke with two yesterday, nobody today, over.
That's fine. We don't want to duplicate it, but I appreciate you coming back anyway, over.
November
4, Victor Alpha, this is Alpha Alpha Romeo 4 Papa Lima. Well, thank you, sir, and 73, I'm clear. Have a great day.
Alpha Alpha Romeo 4 Papa Lima, Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec.
That's Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec.
Roger, Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec. My name is Gary. I am located in Wake County, North Carolina, where it is clear, 62 degrees, light wind, all utilities operating.
Has anybody contacted you earlier? Have you given any other report for Wake County? Over.
Negative. This is the first and only report.
Well, thank you, sir. So, as far as within the county, you got power, water, medical, sanitation, all the utilities are working, over?
That's correct. Everything is up and operating properly.
Okay, thank you, sir. I appreciate that, and I'll get my report in. And you have a great day. Appreciate you coming back. KN4 Alpha Quebec, this is Alpha Alpha Romeo 4 Papa Lima. Thank you, sir.
Roger, can you tell me where you're located? You got a good strong signal here.
Sure. I'm actually in a little town called Summerfield, which is northwest of Greensboro.
Okay. Just over across the state a little bit. Thank you very much. 73 KN4AQ.
We're back. Let's get all of us back here.
Okay. Yeah, that was a nice loud signal. What time of day was that?
Well, it's an interesting point. First of all, the broadcasts were at night around... what, 10 or 11 o'clock at night?
Right.
So we had nighttime propagation. And that that contact was, got the wrong thing switched in here. Yeah. No? I think I see what's happened. It's, I think maybe Dave's disappeared off the call.
No, I'm here.
Oh, he's there.
I'm listening.
I'll just shift.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Things have messed up here on my Skype. Fortunately, Dave is doesn't have to watch all this stuff.
So no, it's kind of a static display, so we're good.
So then, but you'll be fascinated to watch the online playback once we're all done and I get it edited.
Right.
So the broadcast, where we heard the stations on both coasts, was at nighttime propagation. And I've got a pretty high noise level. It's about S7 or so. If you could hear that the East Coast station sounded like they were buried in the noise, but if I had had an S1 or S2 noise level, You would have heard her fine. And then the contact with the station just near Greensboro, North Carolina, about almost 70 miles away, was 10 o'clock in the morning. So daytime propagation. And I think most hams don't realize that that 60 meters in the daytime, and even 75 meters to a large extent in the daytime, are pretty interesting local to close-in regional bands. Very few people use them that way, but from here, if I could get rid of my noise level, I would have contact capability between 60 and 80 meters to several hundred miles from my little station, bigger than the biggest wide coverage repeater. And
yeah, that's the near vertical incident skywave propagation, the NVIS propagation. And that's what RMARS members really make use of to do the statewide and even regional comms. We focus on those NVIS communications, which is typically 10 megahertz and below, is where we make our money for those types of contacts.
Yeah. And regional is mostly what you need for any kind of tactical emergency communications. Mm-hmm. Not a lot of call for making contacts from the east to the west coast most of the time.
Yeah, we do have national nets that support these types of exercises for relaying messages from east coast to west coast and all points in between. But trying to hit east coast to west coast and the middle of the country, you know, varying propagation that goes on there. And so, you know, you have to have relay stations to make sure that all those areas are covered. You had mentioned that the 60-meter broadcast was nighttime only, and we did that purposefully because we wanted to go for as long range as we could. We only did it for an hour because this was really just a proof of concept. We were trying to see, could we get the process approved through command channels to use the military station? Would the DOD and NTIA buy off on that? Especially us trying to use our full authorization for power, and would the FEMA folks would they buy into this concept as well? And so we had very good results with all of that. And so if we do this again for future exercises, we're also going to look at trying to target some daytime frequencies and run probably a couple of broadcasts at varying times during the night and also during the day. Just to further expand on the concept.
In addition to the 60-meter activity, you guys were encouraging your Mars operators. And by the way, did you recognize the guy that I talked to, his call sign?
I did not. I wrote it down, and I'm going to send him a note to make sure that he watches this and lets him know that he got his 15 minutes of fame.
All right. So... You had you were encouraging your local operators to also make contact on VHF repeaters, VHF, maybe UHF repeaters. David Goldenberg, I think you found, you were looking for some VHF activity, didn't find any?
Yeah, we looked around. So, you know, I participate in three or four local nets every week, and I did put out requests on all those nets to see if there was anybody there. Actually went into our local HRO and talked to one of the people there, and he said, "Oh, I know a couple of Mars guys," and actually called one of them on the phone that I talked to, and he said that guy knew, and I don't remember that guy's call sign. He said he knew about the event, knew it was going on, but didn't have the capability or the time at this particular time to participate in it.
Okay, so you didn't find any, and I didn't try. I was busy during the day, other than the 60-meter contact. But Paul or Dave, what kind of reports did you get back from the VHF guys?
Dave, do you want to take that one?
I don't know that I got anything back on the VHF stuff, Paul. I didn't see any reports on that. I just didn't have any visibility to that. I talked with Mike Abbott's, but I didn't see anything over.
Yeah, and on our side as well, we weren't tracking down to what band or what mode was being used. We were more interested in trying to make sure that we were capturing the call signs because it was my intent to get QSL cards out to everybody. But that's certainly a future data point that we will look to start collecting so that we can determine, you know, how the frequencies are being used and what's most effective. The other point about 60 meters, if I can jump back for a second, I received several comments from the amateur radio community that I put out some bad intent on how we were going to use 60 meters. It was my intention that we were going to use all five channels to make contacts. And what ended up happening, as you heard in the script, it was everybody make contact on this channel. And so that's how we ended up with a lot of pileups and folks stepping on one another. You know, so as after action from this exercise, when we do this again, we're going to split regions onto the different 60 meter frequencies so that we can alleviate some of that congestion. And also, you know, your point about collecting some metrics about the bands that are being used, you know, I think that would be useful. What we're trying to do is not set up specific times where Mars folks and amateur radio can come together. We are trying to build the cooperation between the Mars community and amateur radio community so that if you have a regular recurring net on a VHF or UHF repeater, that's where we want the Mars operators to go, to those existing nets, existing net times, as opposed to trying to set up something specific. Because we want this to be as free-flowing and a coordinated, uncoordinated pickup game, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and that would be during exercises and when you're trying to just scope things out, see how well they work. When you're actually cooperating with the ham operation in real emergencies, should that situation arise, and it probably will, then any time you'll be there on any frequency, any time.
And I think I talked about it on the first one of these sessions, the work that we did with the hurricane watch net when the hurricane, I can't think of the name, was traveling up through and destroying Haiti again.
I think it was Matthew.
We reached out to, yes, yeah, that was it. We reached out to the Hurricane WatchNet folks, got great cooperation from them, and we didn't stand up any Mars nets. We went to the existing Hurricane WatchNet to gather the information that we needed, and that's the perfect example for how we see this thing playing out should it happen for real.
So I have a question, Paul. So the three PowerPoints that Gary showed, and I think you said there was about 500 plus contacts. Those were all only the 60 meters or contacts, or you didn't really differentiate between the ones you got on the HF net versus the reports you may have gotten from other operators for local traffic?
No, the slides that were shown earlier and the QSL card that went out were only based upon the 60 meter reception reports.
Okay.
We haven't published the county's contacted map yet. That's still being worked.
Do you have an idea of how many contacts were made in that area?
Yeah, for the counties contacted, we had 998 unique ham call signs that submitted a county status report. Now, because we had advertised this as a special event station in QST, and because we had told our membership that we intended to send out QSL cards, we ended up with a lot of duplicate reports. So one county could have had 4, 5, 6 or even more amateur call signs associated with that. And so we're going through doing that analysis. So 998 unique call signs, and I think we're sitting somewhere around about 1,000, maybe 1,100 counties that were contacted and that they provided a county status report, which a year ago, 15-4, the exercise, we were at 842 counties. So we've made a slight improvement, but still more room to grow there.
There's about a little over 3,000 counties totally in the U.S., so that's a third. That's not bad.
Yeah, 3,143 counties.
Oh, you must be a county hunter.
Nope, it was just part of the metrics. I was trying to figure out, you know, when we say we're going after all counties, you know, what did that actually mean? And so thank you, Google.
Okay. On 60 meters, the guy that I talked to was using his Mars call sign. And somebody made a note on maybe it was QRZ.com or maybe it was on the comments on YouTube that 60 meters is the only spectrum that hams can talk directly to military stations. I don't know if that's true or not, but on the VHF stations, were they using their ham call signs or were they using their Mars call signs?
So on VHF and UHF, the Mars operators should have been using their amateur radio call signs. On 60 meters specifically, the federal government and DHS FEMA are the primary authorization holders for those 60-meter channels. Mars has joint use along with Coast Guard and some other federal agencies. So we're authorized to use government call signs on those channels. And because those are government authorizations, that's why we are also allowed to go up to 3 kilowatt power, whereas on the amateur radio side, you're limited to only 100 watts. So because they're on a federal authorization, we can run up to 3K and we can use our Mars call signs. And you know, those are the only frequencies where you can talk government to amateur radio to government. There are some hams out there who are concerned about the language in 97.111. But in our research with DHS, who is also coordinating with the FCC, the ruling is the language in 97.111 authorizes those types of communications necessary to facilitate emergency response.
So that's one of those anything goes yep. situations.
Right. Yeah, and as long as everyone is operating in good faith of that, it is highly unlikely that the FCC would come down on anybody, you know, as an adverse action, you know, to have an amateur radio station talking to a government station. As long as they're not causing willful interference and are cooperating with the training that's going on, there should be no issues whatsoever.
Yeah, and even if the FCC did, they just say, tell us what you did. You respond and say, there's something wrong with that. I won't do it again. Mm-hmm. They don't pull your license for doing something like that. There is also though, an annual crossband test where hams can talk to military stations and it's, they stay on their frequencies. Many of them, the same ones you guys use, and we stay on ours and they listen in the ham band and we listen outside. I've made one contact like that. I guess that's sort of a special authorization as well.
Yes, it is. That is specifically called out as a subparagraph in 97.111. That is also in our authorization documents. So we have a DOD instruction that authorizes us to do that, as well as a public affairs authorization that allows us to do that. And the purpose of that is to promote that spirit of cooperation again between DOD stations and the amateur radio community. Now that you mentioned it, it's almost time to start working that coordination. Armed Forces Day typically is every year in May. Because of the date conflict with Dayton, which falls on the true Armed Forces Day, we always do the amateur radio crossband portion the week prior to Dayton so that we can maximize the number of hams who are able to participate. And as you said, amateur radio folks, they'll be talking on ham bands. And the Mars folks and government stations will be talking on government spectrum. And we publish an annual message that gets publicized that tells where each of the government stations will be broadcasting and where they will be listening.
Yeah, when I've made one contact that way. And the guy I talked to was very friendly. I think he said he wasn't a ham, but He took his time. I asked him some questions about the equipment he was using. I think they were using Harris stuff. Harris is popular in the in military. And it described his big rhombic antenna and his high-powered station. I don't remember what bands we were crossing, but it was a very interesting contact. And he enjoyed talking to me. I enjoyed talking to him. Sounds like you're deeply involved in that.
Yeah, we run lead on that. Juanita Ports out at the Gateway Station at Huachuca. She does the coordination with Dave Stapchuk and his folks, as well as the Navy. We still have Navy museum ships that participate. This year we had the U.S. Naval Academy had stations on the air from Annapolis. Dave Stapchuk, you have a number of stations. Anything you'd like to highlight there?
No, it just highlights that cooperation that we have. And, I think we had six stations on from the West Coast to East Coast. And then, those Navy historical museum ships that broadcast. So, that was really good. It turned out really well. Lots of contacts, lots of QSL cards after the event, but, it keeps you busy.
The other thing that we started this year was our second year. Was doing ALE crossband. We've been coordinating with Bonnie from the ALE side and trying to promote the use of ALE for those crossband exercises. I know we've had a few contacts that way, and we're hoping to continue to grow that ALE capability.
Let's take a moment to explain what ALE means.
ALE is automatic link establishment. Essentially, you configure your radio into scan groups, typically of 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 channels, and everybody are scanning those same channels, and you designate the call sign of the station that you would like to contact. You dial that into either your hardware radio or your software that's running ALE, and you tell it that you want to place a call, and it will sequentially call on each of those frequencies until it does a handshake with the distant station, and it figures out which channel is going to give the best propagation. It does a link request, it links, and then you can either talk voice or digital.
Okay, so it's basically trying a bunch of different bands. And
yes.
Does it stop with the first contact it makes, or does it try the other bands too? Because the first contact might not be the best.
Yeah, if the signal strength is not going to make a good contact, or the station responding with an acknowledgement, may hear the transmitting station, but the receiving station may not hear that, and so it'll just keep going, and they'll keep scanning and trying additional frequencies until they're able to find one that works.
All right, you earlier had mentioned working in cooperation with FEMA, and I've got a sort of a left field question about that. Here in North Carolina and a bunch of other states, there is now an operation, sort of an organization called Oxcom. Now, the term Oxcom gets used in several different aspects when it comes to FEMA and the Office of Emergency Communications. So it gets a little bit confusing, but here in North Carolina, South Carolina, a couple other states, well, here we've got something called the Oxcom Society, which is sort of an organization. And what they say is that ARRIES, MARS, National Guard, Civil Air Patrol, all of the auxiliary communications units come into emergency management here in North Carolina under the banner of Oxcom. And one of the things they're proudest of saying is when you come in the door, you leave your badge, whoever recruited you, whatever organization, at the door, and you come in and now you're working for emergency management as part of the incident command system. How does that play with the MARS guys? Are you as much a part of that as it sounds?
So from the MARS community, that type of work is what we call defense support to civil authorities. And I think I mentioned this on the first program, there was the appearance and sometimes the outright actions where MARS was in direct competition of ARRIES and RACES, where we were trying to put MARS members down into state, county, local EOCs and really carry that banner. What we are trying to showcase is there is a role for every organization. So if you think about geographically, at the local level, those folks that are manning those EOCs are probably either going to be ARRIES folks or RACES folks, right? And that's mostly local, maybe up to county, maybe regional or state types of communications. Where the MARS piece comes in is our support to DOD, and under the bad day scenario, we are trying to collect information from region, state, county level. So we view MARS as more of a national down to regional, down to county, and we view ARRIES and RACES as the local, county, up to state types of communication. So we're trying to make sure that we know where our limits of authority are and where we can be the most effective. And that's why we're really promoting this interoperability to between the Mars community and the amateur radio community. It's not a competition. There will be more than enough work for everybody. Now that I've gotten off my soapbox, I'll say that the OXCOM course, which is given by DHS Office of Emergency Communications, I took one of those courses at Dayton. And it's not so much about communications. It's about how do you, as an individual who happens to be a communicator, fit into the incident command structure. And you are absolutely right. When you come in under the OXCOM banner, you know, they want you to leave your parent organization behind, and they want you to fall into the incident command structure, and whatever the incident commander or the emergency management coordinator, whatever they need done, that's what those OXCOM personnel are there to do. They may put you on a first responder radio to monitor nets. They may put you on an Aries RACES net to monitor what's going on. They may have you running a log for the EOC. It's whatever the incident commander or the emergency management coordinator needs done is what they're promoting under OXCOM.
All right. When we're doing things like that through Aries, the guys on top of us for Aries start with our state and then ARL headquarters. But that's a weak sort of management. It, you know, they're kind of hands off in terms of what you're going to do down here at the state. Now, you guys are military. You're under the auspices of the Air Force and Navy. And that seems Army. Like it would be a little bit...
Army.
Army. Sorry. Sorry, guys.
You promoted me.
Yeah. Whoa. I'll let you guys take that offline. That would seem to be a little bit more rigid management or a supervisory structure. But I take it that when a Mars operator goes into an incident command location, your brass don't have any real trouble with the idea that, okay, you're working for incident command, you're using your radio skills to do whatever they need you to do, whether it's local dispatching or HF communication or whatever. So they do that. Have I got that about right? And, you know, no problem with you guys not working directly for a military hierarchy?
Well, it depends on what that individual Mars member has gone to that EOC to do. We strongly encourage our members to be involved in Aries, to be registered with the Emergency Management Coordinator as a RACI station. I am, in fact, registered with Bell County, Texas, as the RACI's officer for the county, but I'm also a Mars member. So it depends on what's going on. If there's something state, county, local that's going on, and the Emergency Management Coordinator needs to activate Aries, RACI's, or OXCOM, then I would go into the county EOC as Paul English, WD8DBY, amateur radio guy. If there's something bigger than that, you know, verging on a very bad day, then I will be, you know, Paul English, the Mars member, operating under that structure, interfacing with amateur radio operators for county status, that sort of thing. So it really depends on the scenario that you've put me in as to where I'm going into that EOC, you know, what hat I'm wearing.
All right. So if the military really needs you to provide that input, that's who you're working for. If they don't, then you can work with the rest of the communications guys and get on the air as purely an OXCOM operator.
So yes, Paul, if you were deployed like that, would you have equipment that you'd bring along to be able to communicate with the Mars system, as it were? You know, I guess I'm trying to go to, you know, if you're talking to the Mars folks and you're on the Mars nets, you know, you've got to have Mars equipment, and I'll assume that they'll be looking for whatever information that you're going to provide them, but you'd have to be capable and equipped to do that. I'll assume that most EOCs don't have that already in place.
Yeah, for example, when I went to my local county EOC, cranked up the radios, you know, just to test them out to see if they were opened up. And in fact, they were not. You know, they were just straight out of the box amateur radio gear. So, you know, if I were deploying into a situation like that, and I thought that there was a capability or a possibility that this thing would expand farther, yeah, certainly I would pack my Mars Go kit, and I may never pull it out, but at least have it in the back of the pickup truck ready to go should I need it. You know, and should the situation warrant, you know, just move the coax over and replace the EOC radio with the Mars radio if the situation warranted that.
I think you mentioned this in the first program, but I don't recall. Are there still Mars VHF repeaters scattered around the country?
There are. Most of ours are concentrated in the Northeast. We have... Yeah, primarily in the Northeast. We have some in Texas, Region 6. We have some in California. I believe there's some up in the state of Washington, Oregon, et cetera. Dave, how about you?
You know, the metropolitan areas are probably where the highest concentrations of the VHF repeaters are, but those geographical areas are pretty much the same. There are some on some military installations around. I think we... around here, but yeah, they're scattered far and wide, west coast, east coast. There's some in the middle of the United States also. So there is a variety of stations across the 48 contiguous states.
Are they operational for Emcomm, or are they purely logistics?
Well, the way we use ours. Like Dave said, they're primarily around metropolitan areas. So, for example, the repeater that we have in Dallas, our Mars members in and around Dallas will use that repeater during the exercises to coordinate and traffic load messages between themselves, so that one station isn't handling, you know, 20 or 30 messages. He can pass some of those off to other stations that they can traffic load and help out. They also use those repeaters to coordinate what we call a regional operations group, where they will have a virtual operations center coordinating on the VHF repeater or simplex channels if they're close enough, you know, to coordinate activities and make sure that incoming requests for information are being handled. And those VHF repeaters just allow them to better operate without tying up a lot of HF activity.
Sounds like a great idea. I want to go back into some history for a moment, some of my history and some of Mars history. I was telling you guys before we got started here online that I had a Mars call back in probably the 1960s and operating on 6 meters. That call was Alpha Foxtrot Bravo 9, November Sierra Oscar. And that was based on my ham call, WA9NSO. So the prefix got shifted a little bit, and the suffix, I kept my original suffix. That is ancient history, right? Not done that way anymore.
Correct.
Everybody gets a new call sign.
They do. And it's usually, I'll tell you that the Air Force prefixer, depending if you're in training or if you have if it's a military installation or if it's an individual Mars station, the prefix is different. And then you have individuals that are assigned, I'll say, leadership positions. They get a billet call sign associated with the job that they do. It might be a regional director or a ecom guy or whatever. So they use that if they're working in that capacity or if they're on the nest in that capacity. But the call signs are associated regionally with the 10 FEMA regions across the United States. So the locality, the call sign would be associated so that you know where generally that person is located.
If they move to a different part of the country, then they swap call signs?
They would change their call sign. Absolutely, yeah. Right.
Because the ham system had that for a long time, and then we dropped it so you can't tell where somebody is. Like, for example, David, you're a zero.
Yep.
You belong in Iowa or Colorado.
Or Colorado. Yeah, exactly.
Yep. And I finally,
in the same way, I'm an eight in Texas.
Yeah. I finally recognized what the DHG was. That's your initials.
Yes. Right. It's a vanity call. And when I went to get it, I started with six and there wasn't an N or a W or a K available. So that was the next one I checked was a zero and that one came up and there was N zero DHG, but I looked at that and it's like, no, and I just thought, I took the whiskey.
You didn't want to be kilo delta six DHG, right? You wanted to get rid of that.
I was trying to shorten it. And at the time, and I still have aspirations to extra at some point. But at the time I thought, I'm just going to get this and keep it. And even when I have the opportunity to shorten it off, I'm just going to leave it as it is.
Yeah. Now the extra won't do you any good because
license plate for my car.
Yeah, there aren't any shorter extra calls available until somebody dies anyway. So.
Right, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I lost my opportunity for K4AQ. The guy who had that died, and I was not watching. So next question out of history, and this is going to tax my memory even more, and I think I may fail here, is that I believe when I got started, it was the military affiliate radio system, and it's not that anymore?
That's correct. I believe that changed in 2009. The retitling of the program, and then at the same time they rewrote the governance, the Department of Defense governance that did that to give it better identify what we do versus affiliate versus an auxiliary. But there have been multiple changes of the name over the years. You know, we're 91 years old and there have been multiple changes across that time. So it just kind of the name change kind of helped us associate more with what we do. But that was actually before I even got into Mars. So maybe Paul has a little bit more definition, but I think that was the gist of the name change and kind of to better define or associate the name with what we do.
You nailed it, Dave.
All right.
So I'm two for two. And let me try for one more. And that is when I got in, I think any ham could join with a tech license or above. And that is the case today. Any ham can join tech license or above. But was there a period where it was more restrictive, where there were more stronger limits on who could become a Mars station?
Well, on the Army side, while we encourage you to join as a technician, we took another step and we asked that if you come in as a technician that you upgrade to a general within a year. It is our goal.
Okay. I'm not sure what it is I think I'm remembering, but it was something about just being a ham, even a general or above, didn't get you there. You needed some other military affiliation. And I think I may be totally off base on that.
I don't have enough history here in front of me. I mean, if you were interested, I could probably do some research on that. But there may have been some restrictions, and it might have been just technical. If you look back historically, the mission has kind of changed over the years. Most of the people that you talk to historically will think about the Mars grams and the messages that were being transferred back and forth between our deployed service members, whether they were in Korea or Vietnam or wherever they were deployed at, because there just wasn't phone calls were expensive, weren't available. So a lot of the Mars activity were in the Mars grams, that messages back and forth with families during the day. So, and I don't even know. And we would have had Mars operators stationed around the world. And we used to have a lot more Mars stations. I know the Air Force had Mars stations back in the day on almost every Air Force installation, but that changed. And so with the advent of new technologies, cell phones, computers, Skype, those Mars grams are still done, but they're not as prevalent as they were back in the day. So it might have been a technical capability or a radio capability that you might have needed, but I don't think that it was a definite association. But a lot of the operators were more military. There wasn't as much involved in the amateur side over.
Well, I could see from the amateur perspective, you'd want them to get out of technician into general so that they could do some HF at all. Because otherwise, you really can't. You're really not supposed to, as a technician, get into 60 meters or some of the other bands.
Yeah. So when you join as a MARS member, you no longer need that FCC license to operate on HF. But what we're going after is upgrading to a general, introduces them and gets them familiarity with the HF communications. And that's what we're really going after is trying to get folks experienced in the HF side.
Yeah. And there's no Morse code requirement anymore. So it's, you know, it's really pretty easy. If you've got a tech, the upgraded general is not a big step. So people should be able to do that.
Time to study and time to take the test.
Yeah. So I think you did talk about this in our previous show as well, but let's review it briefly. Who are you looking for? Why would someone want to be a member, and what do you want to get out of them?
Dave, do you want to go?
Well, you know, I think we're looking for folks that are dedicated and want to support. A lot of folks have this a need or want to help support the Department of Defense. I would say not everybody, but a lot of them are prior military or have some sort of military obligation and feel that it's a way to use one of their hobbies to help help the United States. So we're looking for folks that want to do some stuff. We're a little bit more regimented than the amateur community, the average net or the guy just getting on doing DXing or whatever. So it allows you to expand your capabilities. We're expanding into ALE. We're using digital communications now. We encrypt messages. So it gives you some opportunity to expand your radio capabilities and interface with some things that you haven't done in your amateur side. And it does take a little bit more dedication, but there's lots of people out there that want to do it. So the folks that are interested can contact us and come on board. So that there's a place for all those folks to join.
How many volunteer or amateur volunteers do you have on the books? Do you know?
I think we fluctuate. I will tell you that number honestly changes day to day, but we average about 1,100 volunteers in the Air Force MARS at any one time. But honestly, that number changes day to day. There are people that get in and then decide that it might not be for them. And then there's people that have been in MARS for an extended period of time. And then, people come and go. They're hot. They're available time changes. They don't, their life's activities change, so they can't participate. So they'll either drop out or take a leave of absence. So there's a lot of different reasons why people join into MARS, whether it's a sense of country support or a renewed interest, trying some different processes. Just about anything you can imagine that an amateur radio would want to do or why they'd want to do it would be some of the same reasons that they would want to join into the MARS program. And camaraderie is another piece. It's another way to meet a different venue of amateur radio operators that are expanding their skills.
On the Army side, we sit around 1,200 volunteers. And just like Dave on the Air Force side, that tends to fluctuate, but we're holding steady right around 1,200.
Is there a lot of interaction between the Army and the Air Force MARS operators? You guys are just straight across the board at just about the affiliation.
Sure. The joint piece of that is like as with the active duty and the Guard and Reserves. We are a joint team. We work together. It should be almost seamless with what we do. We're continuing to improve that. So, yeah, there's a little bit of Air Force Blue versus Army Green pride in the service. But I think that little bit of I won't say competition, but pride in the color of the uniform that you wore. And a lot of people become from the Air Force that join the Air Force MARS or Army MARS. But no, we have a great working relationship with the Army as we do with the amateur community. And Navy folks that were in the Navy program before have joined both branches of the MARS service components.
When Dave and I ran the after action report from exercise 16-4, that was one of the comments that really stood out across all 10 regions. We heard nothing but good compliments about the working relationship between the Army and the Air Force components in each of those regions. So, a lot of great work going on out there. Folks are working hard. We're working hard to support the mission. And yeah, while there is that good spirited competition, that always works to our benefit because it inspires people to do better. And I think this exercise was proof in the pudding that coming out of this, we saw a lot of good cooperation between the services, and looking to continue that.
Let me decode the 16-4. You called it the exercise 16-4. 2016 fourth quarter. You guys do this four times a year. We're making a big deal out of it, but you do this four times a year.
Yeah, the fourth one, the dash four, that has turned into our 48-hour exercise. This is, I believe, the third one where we've run it for 48 straight hours. The 16, 1, 2, and 3, we use those more as a train-up to the dash four, but we'll focus on different training events during each of those exercises. But those 16, 1, 2, 3, those are typically 8 hours, maybe 12 hours, very compressed so that we're not burning people out. And then the 16-4 is where we're trying to get all hands on deck and really timeline these events out and try to put some realism into the exercise.
So you got some plans for what you're going to do next year?
Yeah, I was working with the headquarters that we support. I was on the phone with him just last night talking about that. We're getting the exercise schedule laid down. It'll be four exercises again next year. Typically January, February timeframe, and then April, May, and then again in August, and then October, November will be those exercise timeframes.
All right. I can't promise we'll do a Ham Radio Now show for every one of them, but we probably like to get back on and talk to you guys again.
Are the first four during the year, are those interoperability or are those mostly internal?
The first one, the dash one, is typically internal. We use that just to shake the holiday cobwebs off. And, when we change the encryption keys, make sure everybody has that. Any new software loads, make sure that we give folks time internally to shake the cobwebs, update systems and that sort of thing. And then two and three is where we start to look at doing more interoperability with the amateur radio side. And then, of course, the dash four being the biggie. But the other thing that we don't want to do is we also don't want to burn out our amateur radio counterparts in trying to tax and take up too much of their time. And so we're trying to be judicious in how we do these exercises so that we get the most benefit with the resources, the people resources that we can.
All right. A few minutes ago, Dave Stapchuk mentioned that your operations are a little more, I forget the word you use, regimented or formal. And you laughed at that. I laughed at that. You're very formal. The guy that I talked to on my 60-meter contact sounded ham-ish. He was not being formal, but you guys are very crisp in all of your communication. Can you, Paul and Dave, give me a short example of a two-way exchange using the kind of crispness that you guys would use?
I think we can.
Yeah. Paul, go ahead and call Dave.
Okay. Let me think about this for just a second. Let me get the script in my mind of what I want to do.
You got to make up that traffic.
That's it. That's it.
Let's just, I don't know. I don't know what would be typical traffic. How about a net report or,
how about a radio check?
Oh, sure. That's simple.
This is Alpha Golf, Alpha 5 Charlie, radio check over.
Alpha Golf, Alpha 5 Charlie, this is Alpha, Alpha, Alpha 6 Bravo, loud and clear, out.
Alpha, 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 I didn't catch your call sign, Paul. I didn't write it down. I got a bunch of scribbles here.
Okay, now, what would you
loud and clear, over.
Okay, Dave, what would you really do in that situation? What would you really say if you didn't have the call sign?
I'd ask him to repeat it.
And what would that sound like?
This is Alpha Golf, Alpha 5 Charlie. Can you repeat your call sign, over?
This is Alpha, Alpha, Alpha 6 Bravo, over.
Alpha, Alpha, Bravo 6, over. This is Alpha Golf, Alpha 5 Charlie. Read you loud and clear, over.
Roger out.
Roger. Okay, so Dave, we're going to out you now. What you were telling us before we started recording was that you're pretty new to this radio stuff, at least the ham and Mars part of it.
I am.
How did that come about? What's the deal?
How did it come about? Well, you know, I work for the Department of Defense. I work for the Air Force, and I changed jobs. I've had a multitude of jobs in the – I was in the Air Force for 28 years. I retired, worked for a defense contractor for a few years, and then joined on as a civil servant. And I had the opportunity to switch jobs, and this job was kind of selected for me. But I had a background in as electronics technician. I have a background with radios. I spent almost 15 years supporting Air Force, the solar observatories in Boston and Learmonth, Australia. So we had radio and optical telescopes. I maintained those. So the radio portion of that is not new to me. The technology behind it, it's just all the handshaking and the particulars. But I am I got my amateur license. It was like getting a golden handshake. Everybody was happy that I got my amateur license, and I'm progressing down that road, and I'm going to be installing a radio here at the house so that I can participate on the net. So getting my amateur call sign was a big deal. I was brought into the fold. So everybody accepted me. So it's good. It's a great job. I really enjoy it. Working with a bunch of volunteers, it's probably one of the better jobs in the Air Force. I'm pretty fortunate over.
Yeah, you stepped up, and that always gets us pretty excited when somebody does that. So congratulations. Welcome. Thank you. You've been a ham for a few years now. When did this happen?
Me? Two years ago for the Dayton Hamvention, the weekend before the Hamvention, I told everybody that I would have my license before I got to Dayton. So I literally took the test over the weekend so I could get my license and come with my call sign. So somebody, I had made a commitment and I followed through on that. So it was actually a lot of fun.
We're proud of you. David Goldenberg, I'm out of questions here. You got anything that's been hanging fire for you?
I think we pretty much covered it all. You know, wanted to know how it went and how many people and what they thought and how can we help? And we've gone through all that.
All right.
I would definitely want to try to do this again next year as they get to the interoperability and make sure we do a little earlier so we could generate some more contacts for you.
Yeah. One last thing then, if we've attracted anybody's interest here into getting into Mars, what's their route? How should they find you guys?
You can contact me at paul.a.english, like the language, .civ@mail.mil, or you can reach me on telephone 254-630-9472.
All right. And you guys got a website, I imagine, that people can.
Yes, it's usarmymars.org. A lot of good information, plus membership applications.
All right.
We don't have a website at this time, but you can contact me at david.stapchuk@us.af.mil. And I can be reached at commercial phone number 618-229-5964. And we'll be happy to entertain and help you get set up. Again, Air Force or Army Mars, come on board and get on the team. We'd be happy to bring you on board.
All right. So as much a fraternity and community as you guys have, it's separate memberships. You got to choose. Can you be a member of both?
You cannot.
You cannot.
You got to make a choice. Can you be a member of one and then for some who knows why reason, leave that and join the other?
That has happened. Absolutely.
Okay. So you're not blackballed.
No, absolutely not. Well, you know, we're on the same team. We're working together to meet our mission requirements. And Air Force blue and Army green. And we have our Navy counterparts. We have folks that are in the Coast Guard and folks that have never been associated with the military. So we have a great dynamic and a group of amateur radio operators that come from a diverse background and diverse skills. They all bring something to the table.
All right. David, I'm going to drive these guys crazy in just a moment. And Paul, you may remember how I drove you crazy at the end of the last show.
I vaguely remember.
Yeah, given the precision of the communications that you guys use. But first, I have to point behind me. There he is. He's wearing his Santa hat. That's our mascot, Arvin. Arvin is the chief financial officer of Ham Radio Now. He's in charge of the money. And it costs a little bit of money to, I mean, look at all this stuff. It costs money to do this. If you enjoy the programs, get something out of them, especially these Emcomm Extra versions, stop by our website, hamradionow.tv, and you'll find Arvin sitting there at the bottom, and he'll take you to the contribution page. You can do a Patreon, which is a monthly contribution, little as a buck, 12 bucks a year. You can do credit cards through or PayPal or a regular credit card, whatever you want to do. Contributions have been pretty good, so I thank everybody who has helped us financially and get things working. And so that's it for the financial pitch. Dave Stapchuk, this is going to drive you nuts.
Okay.
But I'm gonna assign each of you a role. And that's the way we close the program routinely. It is purely bad Hollywood radio procedure. So let's see. We'll identify ourselves first. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. And then over here on the Skype line, David first.
And I'm David Goldenberg, Whiskey Zero, Delta Hotel Golf.
And Paul?
Paul English, WD8DBY.
And Dave?
KD9DXM, the DX machine.
Okay. Here's the assignment. Dave Goldenberg, you go over.
Yep.
Paul English, you say and. Dave Stapchuk, you say out. It's the old Dick Tracy, over and out. Drives you crazy? If somebody said that, you'd boot them off the net? But I'm going to make you do it. So, David, you're up.
Over
and
out.
I made him do it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. You guys did a great job, and I really want to thank you for hosting Paul and I. I'm very appreciative. I was a little apprehensive, but this went great, and I didn't have to see anything. I've been looking at the static image on the computer all day. That's okay. Thank you again.
You were just in a scene, our ugly faces.
It's all right. Next time I won't use my tablet. I'll use my new computer. So there we go.
All right.
And Gary, David, thanks again for hosting us. It was a pleasure. And Gary, I'll get your QSL card in the mail this weekend.
Thank you. Appreciate it.